Just to be honest, I'm smoking on chronic. I speak in Ebonics, finesse 100. Focus on making some money. Get on the track and go dummy. Bitches a rap like a mommy. I'm a human tsunami. Shoot up your block with a Tommy. As soon as they see me, they running. Niggas, they know how I'm coming. Hop out the car and I'm dumping. Bagging and flipping, no fumble. Paper, I'm washing, no tumble. I am so humble. I am so ready to rumble. Swing at your face and you stumble. Nigga, I do what I wanna. Just to be honest. Nigga, I do what I wanna. Just to be honest. Just to be honest. Nigga, I do what I wanna. Just to be honest. Just to be honest.
What down, family? It's your boy SNTV. Back at y'all with another International Steppers. And this episode is going to be about none other than Wayne Perry, a.k.a. Silk.
We don't need nobody glorifying the game. They got enough fools to do that.
Wayne Silk Perry was born November 14th, 1962. And he comes from that Washington, D.C. area. He grew up in the southwest area of Washington, D.C., and he lived on L Street.
In Wayne Perry's younger years, he actually enjoyed going down to Georgia, where he would spend a lot of his summers. He had family down there. He actually said that he put guys in the dirt in Georgia as well. Also, Wayne Perry was very good at sports. His preference was baseball, but he actually was really good at basketball, football, and boxing also. When he was younger, he stayed across the street from a boys' club, so this is where he learned to practice on his skill. Now, in all actuality, Wayne Perry was good enough to do anything that he wanted to do, especially when it came to sports, but he said that he was more interested in the streets. But Wayne Perry was exceptional at baseball and was even recognized in the Washington, D.C. newspaper for being the top baseball player in the city. Wayne Perry got his nickname Silk from a guy that he called his extended brother, a guy that went by the name of Lop. He said that Lop nicknamed him Silk because he was silky smooth with the ladies and at sports. Wayne Perry would begin his transition from a boy to a man in 1974, when he caught his first body at the age of only 12. When Silk was only 13, he would go on to establish his own crew and begin to learn all type of different hustles. Silk would eventually learn how to cheat with crooked dice while shooting craps. He was so good at it that the older guys would take him with them when they went to gamble because they thought that he was good luck. He would also develop a love for gambling, so much so that he would begin to affiliate himself with all of the gambling spots in D.C. He started hanging on 17th Street, Northwest, where he would do most of his gambling, but he would also hang on 14th Street, 7th Street, and T Street, Northwest, with older guys to watch their back because they knew that if anybody tried anything, no matter if it was police, robbers, or whoever, Wayne Perry was gonna shoot. As a matter of fact, when he would go on robberies with the older guys, they would take the bullets out of his gun because they felt like he was trigger happy. Wayne Perry would start robbing banks in 1978, and his brother would actually get killed by the police in a bank in 1979, which is the same year that he had his first real contact with the police. He was locked up for shooting the hall monitor at Wilson High School, but he was innocent. Apparently, a riot broke out as Wayne Perry began to beat one of his rivals from the Northwest side. In the midst of the riot, a guy pulled out a gun and shot the hall monitor. Wayne Perry was blamed for this because, for one, he was the one that kind of started the riot when he began to beat the dude up from the Northwest. And for two, they knew that if they blamed Wayne Perry, he was just gonna bite the bullet and he wasn't gonna say nothing. He ended up beating that case in court. For the riot incident, Wayne Perry would be kicked out of Wilson High School and would begin attending Randall, where he would eventually be kicked out of all DC public city schools for beating the baseball coach with a baseball bat. In 1984, Wayne would go to jail once again, this time for killing a guy in front of the police in an incident in which he says was self-defense. Wayne Perry would then be shipped to the Lorden Youth Center, where he will remain from 1984 to 1987. He would get out in 87 just in time to watch his father die, who was basically on his deathbed when Wayne got out. Wayne Perry said that seeing his father die actually made him lose his mind, and he began to have a death wish. After Wayne Perry was released from the youth center in 1987 and his father died, he began to really apply pressure to the streets. His crew was full of nothing but loyal soldiers and his proteges, and him and his crew would reign supreme terror upon the streets of DC. He would end up working with Alpo or Albert Martinez in or around 1989, when initially he wanted to kill Alpo because of a rumor that a chick started, but that came back to be a lie. Anyway, he was gonna actually kill Alpo, but Alpo was hanging with a younger guy that went by the name of Pop, that Silk was very well affiliated with. Shortly after Alpo and Wayne's first encounter, two things happened. Wayne Perry ended up getting locked up, and Alpo ended up getting shot by some guys from DC that was trying to stop him from closing in on the territory because he was from New York. So what Alpo decided to do was take the advice of Pop, who told him to go bond Wayne Perry out of jail and that Wayne Perry needed $10,000. Alpo knew that with the reputation that Wayne Perry had in the city of Washington, D.C., that his drug business would expand. Almost immediately after Alpo and Wayne Perry started working together, they started making large amounts of money, with Alpo being the one that, you know, supplied the drugs and pretty much ran the dope operation, and Wayne Perry being the muscle. And when I say muscle, I mean the muscle, the epitome of everything that you did not want to see coming. Wayne Perry is arguably the most feared dude to this day in Washington, D.C. history. There was people that actually told on people in cases to where Wayne Perry was with the people that they told on, but acted like Wayne Perry was never there. And when Wayne Perry was mentioned, they act like they didn't even know who Wayne Perry was. This was a guy that was known for the execution of multiple people in broad daylight in front of hundreds, thousands of people on busy streets. And he dared you to say anything about it. And the ones that did, I mean everyone that did, except for one. And the only reason that that person is still alive to this day is because Wayne Perry couldn't get to him. Everybody that ever tried to testify against him ended up dead. And he accepted contracts. So for him, it was like you shoot to kill, because when you accept a contract, there's no such thing as, oh, the person's not gone. There was a woman that went by the name of Evelyn Carter, and apparently Wayne Perry had put a hit on her because she wouldn't talk to him. Now, this hit that Wayne Perry supposedly had put on her was sent to a guy by the name of Thomas Dozier, who was set out to prove himself to Wayne Perry. Evelyn Carter was attending a concert at the DAR, Constitution Hall, two blocks away from the White House, when somebody walked up and hit her multiple times in the torso. She fell back and went into convulsions. She was later picked up by the ambulance and taken to the hospital, where she later died. Allegedly, the fact that Thomas Dozier didn't shoot her in the head made Wayne Perry mad. So he proceeded to walk up to a guy that was in a phone booth, and just as an example, he hit the guy in the head from point blank range and then told Thomas Dozier, "Now that's how you kill somebody." Wayne Perry is thought to be involved in over 50 murders, but he was only convicted of 5. Allegedly, Wayne Perry gunned down Demencio Benson in front of thousands of witnesses on orders from Alpo, because Demencio Benson was from New York and Alpo had left New York running from people that wanted to kill him from things that he had did in New York, and he didn't want Demencio getting the information back to the people from New York that were seeking to harm him.
And then there was Garrett Terrell, or Big Head Gary, and this is actually supposed to be the guy that pulled the trigger on Rich Porter, and he was killed because basically Alpo was getting tired of him, and the fact that he killed Rich Porter made him a liability, so he had to be exterminated.
He was also convicted of the murders of Yolanda Burley, Alveda Hopkins, and Evelyn Carter, the one I talked about earlier. And in all three of these cases, there were snitch allegations, but the only one that was actually talking to the police was Alveda Hopkins. And even though he was not charged with the murder of Frey, everybody knows that he did it because the murder weapon was found in a Q45 Infinity that was given to him for doing the hit. By DC really won Wayne Perry off of the streets because of his violence and his violent reputation, they offered Alpo a deal and he took it. Wayne Perry was convicted with 5 murders and he was sentenced to 5 consecutive life sentences, and he was sent to ADX Supermax Prison in Florence, Colorado. Michael Salters, aka Frey, who was a legend in his own right, he was gunned down by Wayne Perry on orders from Alpo, and he was basically killed to get him out of the way so that the empire that they had could expand. And not only that, Frey didn't really like guys from New York coming to DC to post up and sell drugs. He didn't like how they operated, and he would get shit from Alpo and not pay Alpo for it. Frey had been in contact with some of his guys from New York that had told him that Alpo wasn't right. So this is pretty much why Frey treated Alpo the way that he did. There were 2 questions that were asked to Wayne Perry during his Don Diva interview, in which I'll post in the description and or the comments. Question: after everything that went down, what are your feelings about Alpo? Wayne Perry's answer: make no mistake about it, Poe is a spineless coward, a rat of the highest order. I would never understand how people praise and romanticize snitches, rats, and sellouts. I would die 1,000 deaths before I ever compromise my principles as a man. As I think back, I always knew Poe was weak and capable of everything he displayed. I had my reasons for not putting him in the dirt. I should have put the barrel in his mouth. Question: do you have any advice for the younger generation? Wayne Perry's answer: it's important that they never take the field and play the game that has no ending and no winners. The game has been tainted by rats. Nowadays, you can't trust guys in the game, especially the ones that seem to be winning, because as soon as the heat comes down, they're selling out. Kingpins are telling on foot soldiers, and etc. This has been the story of Wayne Silk Perry. It's your boy, SNTV. I'm out.
Ain't going up a wage and a genocide upon ourselves. Look at what's going on in Chicago.